Hi, I'm Zor. Welcome to Unizor Education. Today we will continue solving little problems. Actually, I call them exercises because there is nothing actually new about whatever we are going to do. It's just something which we were talking about during the theoretical lectures, and now we are implementing whatever we were talked about in practice. Now, this lecture, as all others, are part of the advanced course of mathematics on Unizor.com. I suggest you to watch this lecture from the website, because the website has very detailed notes which can serve as a textbook. Plus, those who are signed in, there is some kind of a functionality built into the website, like, for instance, taking exams or enrolling into a specific topic. And the site is free, there is no advertising, so please use the website. Now, okay, so let's just do one by one. We have six different exercises on the material which we have covered before in lectures. All right, so number one is, there is a function, and at point x equals to 0, we would like to draw a tangential line, and we need the linear equation actually which represents this tangential line. Well, first of all, let me just draw the graph of this function. Well, e to the power of minus x is something like this, right? And this is 1 at point 0. And x is this. Now we have to multiply them, right? Now, obviously, starting from this to the left, this goes to minus infinity, this goes to plus infinity, their product would be minus infinity going through zero. So in this case, my graph will go something like this. Not linearly, I mean, it looks like a line, like a straight line. It's not definitely a straight line. It's something which goes to infinity in both cases. Now, as far as here is concerned, again, when x goes to infinity, e to the power of minus x goes to zero significantly faster, and we did cover this material. This is something which is little o of this, if you wish. So the result would be on the infinity, it would be going to zero asymptotically. And here, so we are probably rising something, and this is general behavior of the function. So let me just put this as a dotted line. These are my initial functions. And the resulting function is the solid black line. It goes like this. Now, this is point 1. This is point 2. So we are looking at tangential line which looks something like this. And we need the equation of the tangential line. Well, first of all, it's a linear function. Obviously, it's a straight line, which means its equation is this. Now, what is A? Well, A is always a tangent of this line with the x-axis, right? At the same time, we know that the tangential line to a function at a certain point has a tangent with of the angle with the x-axis equals to the derivative of this function at this point. So if we will take derivative of this function at point 2, we will basically have A, right? So let's do it. A is equal to derivative of function f at point x0, which is 2. We can just put 2 here. Now, what is this? Well, let's talk about derivative of this function. It's a product of two functions, which means its derivative is derivative of the first by second plus first on derivative of second. Okay, derivative of first by second would be e to the power of minus x, and plus x times derivative of a to the power of minus x, which is a compound function. First it's the minus x, and then it's e to the power. And its derivative is, first we do the main function, and then we multiply it by derivative of the inner function, which is minus x, which is minus 1 times x, actually, right? So its derivative would be minus 1, so I'll just put minus here. And I should put it at x is equal to 2, which is equal to e to the power of minus 2 minus 2 times e to the power of minus 2. That's my derivative, and that's the a. All right. All right. E to the power of minus 2 minus 2 e to the power of 2. Okay. Now, let's talk about B. What we do know is that at point x is equal to 2, this particular function should give exactly the same value as this particular function, right? So that means that a times 2 plus b should be equal to this function, which is 2 times e to the power of minus 2. Now, we know a, so how can we determine b? Well, b is equal to 2 to the power e to the minus 2 minus 2a minus 2a, which is 2 e to the power of minus 2 plus 4 e to the power of minus 2. That's b. This cancels out. So what do I have now? I have y is equal to e to the power of minus 2 minus 2 e to the power of minus 2 x plus 4 e to the power of minus 2. So that's the equation. The end. Next. Okay, next, the same function. I have to find out maximums, minimums, and inflection points. All right, so I know how it looks graphically. It looks something like this. So this is maximum. And this looks like an inflection point. Because I have here the function has a hump, basically. So it's concave down. And here, since the function goes asymptotically this way, the concavity goes upwards. So that's where we are changing the curvature of the function. Well, let's just do it analytically using the calculus. Well, first of all, we need the derivative, and derivative is f dot x equals e to the power of minus x, that's derivative of this times this, plus this times derivative of this, and the minus sign. Okay, that's a derivative. Now, my first question is, where is derivative equals to 0? That's the stationary points. So if this is 0, then this is 0. Now this is obviously e to the power of minus x, 1 minus x equals to 0. This is not equal to 0, which means x is equal to 1. So this looks like this. Okay, that's fine. We can definitely think about whether this is a minimum or maximum. I mean, well, we kept graphically that it looks like a maximum, but you remember that we can use the second derivative to basically make our determination more precise. So let's talk about the second derivative. So second derivative is derivative of this thing. And again, it's a multiplication of two functions. I will take derivative of this times that. Now this is minus e to the power of minus x times 1 minus x plus this times derivative of this, which is minus 1, so it's minus. So let's think about where this, well, let me just e to the power of minus x times minus 1 minus x minus 1. Am I right? No, plus 1. And plus 1. Sorry. Equals 2 e to the power of minus x times x minus 2. No, this is minus. Minus x, 1. And now there is no minus, I changed the signs here. Yeah, that's the derivative. Now, where is this second derivative equals to 0? Well, obviously that x is equal to 2. Before, to the left of 2, I have this derivative negative. So the second derivative is negative, in particular at point 1, signifies that this is the local maximum. And second derivative being greater than 0 if x is greater than 2 signifies the concavity would be upwards. So this is exactly the point, is x, point x is equal to 2 is exactly where our inflection actually point is. And since there are no other stationary points but x is equal to 1, there is no minimum. So there is maximum, local maximum. There is an inflection point at 2, and there is no minimum. Okay, that's it. Okay. 3. F at x is equal to sine x plus cosine x. I have to determine intervals of increasing and decreasing of this function. Now, you remember, we are talking about obviously smooth function, they are differentiable and derivatives are continuous, etc. So, we can talk about monotonically increasing function having a derivative where it's increasing positive. And if it's a monotonically decreasing function on certain interval, that's where its derivative is supposed to be negative. So we're talking about this monotonic behavior and derivative connection. Monotonically increasing have positive derivative, monotonically decreasing negative. All right, so let's just talk about this particular function. Find its derivative and find where it's positive and where it's negative, right? So, derivative is cosine of x, that's derivative of this, and minus sine of x, that's derivative of that. So, let's talk about positive. So, number one, where is cosine of x minus sine of x greater or equal to 0, or if you wish, cosine of x greater or sine of x. So we have to find this. All right, let's just talk about sine and cosine as they are defined on a unit circle. I think this is the best because sometimes people just divide by cosine. This is not exactly the right way to do, because the cosine can be positive or negative, and if it's negative, then this sign should be reversed, right? So let's not go into these details. Let's talk about the strict definition, and let's talk about sine and cosine when one is greater or less than another. Okay, now sine, as you remember, is, this is sine, and this is cosine. Sine and cosine. Well, let's start from zero. Now, when we are at zero, sine is zero, cosine is an entire radius, right? So point zero definitely satisfies this. Then as we move counterclockwise up to pi over 45 degrees, sine is increasing, cosine is decreasing, right? Sine is increasing, cosine is decreasing, and they are equal to each other exactly at pi over 4, at 45 degrees, right? So the whole area of the angles, which is in this particular sector, satisfies this particular inequality. Next, let's go this way. In this way, you have sine, let's say it's here. Sine is this one, which is negative. Cosine is positive, so it's definitely satisfies our inequality. So any point in this quarter also satisfies our inequality. Let's move further. Now, when we are moving here, our cosine is negative and our sine is also negative. But while we are here, absolute value of a sine, which is this, greater than absolute value of cosine. But since we are talking about negative, the absolute value will be, the sine with absolute value greater than the cosine, since both of them are negative, would be actually less. So it's also our area where this inequality is satisfied. Until they are equal, both are negative and the same absolute value. And starting from this point up to this, very easily we can see that this inequality is not actually satisfied, because the absolute value in this case of a sine is, which is this, is less than absolute value of this, but since they are both negative, sine is greater. And same thing for any point in this quarter, because in this quarter our cosine is negative and sine is positive. So again, this is not satisfied. So the whole half a circle is where this particular inequality is satisfied. So let's just describe it analytically. Well, if this is pi over 4, so we start from this point, which is minus pi over 4, another. So it's minus 3 pi over 4 plus 2 pi n x up to pi over 4 plus 2 pi n. Well, obviously I added the period, right? So that's the solution to this inequality, and that's where our function is increasing. Now, symmetrically, you can derive that it's decreasing, obviously, in this area, which is from from here to here, so it's from pi over 4 plus 2 pi n 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4 plus pi actually, so it's 5 quarters. 5 pi over 4 plus 2 pi. Oh, I didn't put x. So x between these two is where the function is decreasing. So that's the basically all analysis of the behavior of this function, increasing and behavior and increasing. Next. Okay, next we need to find inflection points at this function. Well, the graph of this function, well, you know. So it looks like, you see, in all these areas we have maximums and these are minimums, local. And so the concavity is down here and upwards there, so that must be the inflection point. Now, how can we determine it? Well, remember, the second derivative is supposed to be equal to zero, because here, second derivative is supposed to be negative, since it's a local maximum. Here, second derivative is supposed to be positive, because it's local minimum. So in between, it's supposed to be somewhere in between zero, right? Negative here, positive there, negative zero in between. Okay, let's just take the second derivative. So the first one will be cosine of x. That's the first derivative. And the second derivative would be minus sine of x, right? From cosine, minus sine of x. Now, it's equal to zero, minus doesn't really matter, that's x is equal to pi n, which obviously are these points. So inflection points are actually those points where sine is equal to zero, which is pi n. Okay, next. Okay, next is our old friend but now I would like to have remember, we were talking about tangential line at x is equal to 2. Now I would like to talk about normal, which is perpendicular to a tangential line. Now, how can I find out the equation of the normal? Well, let me start from the beginning. Let's start from the tangential line. So the first derivative is e to the power of minus x, derivative of this times this, plus this times derivative of this, which is minus x e to the power of minus x. That's my first derivative. And at point 2, it's a tangent of this angle. Well, that's minus 2. So I've got tangent of this angle. Now, if two lines are perpendicular to each other, how, knowing one tangent, how to find another one? Well, I have to turn this by 90 degrees, in this case counterclockwise, which means I am reducing the angle by 90 degrees, right, by pi over 2. So if I know that tangent of phi is equal to whatever, let's call it A. Now I'm looking for tangent of phi minus A. Phi minus pi over 2. What is it? Well, let me just remind you that if you have a triangle, if this is angle phi, this is pi over 2 minus phi. It's a right triangle, right? Which means that the tangent of this angle equals cotangent of this angle. And correspondingly, tangent of phi minus pi over 2 equals to cotangent of phi, right? Now, this is true not only, these two identities are true not only with the right triangle where all angles are from 0 to 90 degree to pi over 2, but for any angle. I mean, if you will consider the unit circle, you will have exactly the same thing. So I'm going to use this for here. I'm sorry, I made a slight mistake here. This is pi over 2 minus phi. Because now I see this, I see the difference. So what's the difference? The difference is in the sign. But I know the tangent is an odd function, which means if I change my argument to a negative, my tangent is changed to the negative. So it's minus tangent of pi over 2 minus phi. So I change the sign here, I change the sign of the function. And now knowing this, this is a minus cotangent of phi. So that's what basically I need. I need tangent of this angle, and this is the angle, the tangent of the angle of the normal, because it's this angle minus pi over 2. You know, the clockwise is negative, counterclockwise is positive direction. That's why I subtracted pi over 2, and then I changed the sign to get to this, to use this identity, and that's my answer. Now, what is this? Do I know this? Well, of course, I know the tangent, right? So cotangent is 1 over tangent. So that's my that's my formula which I would like to use. Since I know my tangent phi, I therefore determine my tangent of phi minus pi over 2, which is this, minus 1 over a, where a is my tangent, right? So now I know the tangent of this normal, which is 1 over minus 1 over tangent is my my derivative at point 2, which is e to the power minus 2 minus 2 e to the power minus 2 x. Okay, plus b, some b, and how do I determine b? Well, if I substitute 2 here, I have to get corresponding value here, right? Because they are the same. At this point, they're crossing, they're intersecting, so the value is supposed to be, the value of y is supposed to be equal to the value of function, right? So the value of function is equal to e to the power minus 2 minus 2 e to the power of minus 2, and that should be equal to, if I substitute 2 here, minus 2 divided by e to the power minus 2 minus 2 e to the power minus 2 plus b, from which I can determine the b, whatever the b is. I don't want to go into the details of this. And I've got the equation. Okay, and the last one. General, f of x at point x0, I need to determine basically the equation of tangent, tangential line, and the normal at point x0 to this function. Again, considering that the function is smooth, etc., etc. All right, so whatever the function graph is, for instance, this is the point, so this is my tangential line and this is my normal. Okay. Now, up front, the tangential line should have the tangent of the angle with x-axis equal to the function's derivative at point, at given point. So, f point, f's derivative at point x0 is my coefficient at x, right? Now, how to find the free member? What kind of b should I put here? Well, if I put x0 here, I should have f of x0, right? So f of x0, because they are intersecting, right? So f of x0 is equal to f of x0, x0 plus b. So b is equal to f of x0 minus f of x0 times x0. So the whole equation would look like f of x0 x plus f of x0 minus f of x0 x0, which usually is, they are putting these two together, which is f of x0 times x minus x0 plus f of x0. So this is the derivative at point x0 times x minus x0 plus this. So this is an equation of tangential line, okay? Now, how about the normal? Well, very easy. Normal line is at angle of 90 degree to the tangential line, right? So I immediately, so this is equation of the tangential line. So I immediately know, remember the previous 1 minus 1 over a, if I have a as a tangent, then tangent of phi minus p over 2 would be this. So immediately I can see that my normal is minus 1 over f of x0. Obviously assume that it's not equal to 0 for all these cases. By the way, if derivative at point x0 is equal to 0, which means it's some kind of a local maximum and tangential line is parallel, then what is the normal? Normal is this. And the formula for the normal would be x is equal to x0, right? That's the vertical line, so to speak, in Cartesian coordinates. So let's put this aside and we consider f derivative at x0 is not equal to 0. So that would be x plus b. And again, how do we determine b? Exactly the same way, because this normal, again, at this point, x0, is supposed to have the value equals to f of x0. So the same thing, same technique here. Right? It's supposed to satisfy this. From which b is equal to f of x0 minus 1, no, plus, now plus. It's plus f prime of x0 times x0. So my equation would be, instead of b, I will put this value prime of x0 times x0, or as people again usually do, they factor out this, having x minus x0 here. This is minus, that's why this is minus. This is minus. And plus f of x0. So this is equation of the normal. So whenever you have a function f of x, these are two formulas, which I never remember, by the way. I always derive them. But, I mean, if you remember it, it's fine. This is the equation for tangential line at point x0, and this is equation of the normal line for x is equal to x0. Well, that's it for today. I do suggest you to read all the notes for this lecture on unizor.com. And what probably would be best, if you can just do exactly these exercises by yourself, without looking at the notes, without looking at the lecture itself. And if you come up with exactly the same results, the answers, by the way, are in the notes for this lecture. That's great. Other than that, that's the end of it. Thank you very much and good luck.